Good morning, church. Good to see you all. Since Christmas falls on next Saturday this year, we celebrate today as Christmas Sunday. Now, let us greet each other. Merry Christmas. Merry Christmas. Hello. There will be two services on Christmas Eve. The Christmas Eve healing service, which is a time of reflection and healing, will be held in the chapel at 6 p.m. And the candlelight communion service will be held at 7 p.m. in the sanctuary. Please invite your families, neighbors, and friends to join the service. And also those who want to make a donation for last week's tornado victims, please write the check with reference Relief Fund for Tornado Victims on your check. We will collect them for a month and then send them to the UMCOR, United Methodist Committee on Relief, to support them. Thank you all who placed orders of poinsettias in memory of and in honor of your loved ones. You can find the list of names in your insert. Is there any other announcement? Okay, now it's time for striking the hour while we welcome the light of Christ.
Thank you.
Would you rise for the call to worship? When Mary visited her cousin Elizabeth, their lives were forever changed.
Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit, and Mary proclaimed faith in God, her Savior.
The children they carried in their wombs heralded expectation and hope for the world.
We are heirs of this expectation and hope. We are heirs of this promise of God.
Come, let us worship. Amen. Praise God. You may be seated. Now it's time for Advent candle lighting by our youth group. Wow, today's full house.
Come. Love.
Give us love when all we see is hate.
Give us love when the world feels cold.
Give us love when our hearts feel empty.
Give us love when we see others in need.
Give us love that is contagious.
Give us love that cares for strangers.
Give us love for each other so we can make a difference.
But you, O Bethlehem,
from you shall come forth
one who is to rule.
He shall stand and feed his flock.
In the strength of the Lord,
he shall be great.
He shall be the one of peace.
He shall be Emmanuel.
God with us.
Let us bow our head. Lord Jesus, we lift up our voices of prayer, praise today, as we think especially of your birth on that first Christmas morning. Lord, many people today will be celebrating Christmas Sunday with little or no understanding that in coming to earth in the form of a man, you came to die so that all who believe on your name might be saved from their sins and have life and have it more abundantly. Lord Jesus, you are the light of the world and the Prince of Peace that this world desperately needs. Shine the light of your love deep within the hearts of all those who do not know you. Light the mindset of those, minds of those that are blinded to the truth of the glorious gospel of Christ Jesus, our Lord. And Lord, I pray that you would draw many into your arms of forgiveness so that they too might be made right before you and receive God's peace into their hearts at this time. Grant to all those that know and love you to be specially blessed this Christmas, and may you draw each one ever closer to your heart of love in a world that is becoming darker, so that the light of your truth may shine through us to a world who needs Jesus. God of healing and mercy, we pray for those who have been devastated by recent tornadoes. Lord, you are our refuge and strength, an ever-present help in times of trouble. We pray that your presence would be felt by those who are grieving, who are injured, who have lost their homes and livelihoods. By your Spirit, lift up those who have fallen. Sustain those who work to rebuild, and fill us with the hope of your new creation. We now lift up those who need your healing mercy among us: Ann Harper, Marge Wilson, Deborah Freeman, Carmen Huckabee, and Evelyn West. We ask these prayers in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
Amen. You may be seated. It's time to lift up our offerings and tithes to the Lord. Glorious God, source of every good gift, bless our tithes and offerings this day. May they lift up the Lord, fill the hungry with good things, and bring strength and mercy to those in need. In your holy name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Cooper is going to be our lay reader today.
Our scripture reading is from Luke 1, chapters 39 through 45. In those days, Mary set out and went with haste to a Judean town in the hill country, where she entered the house of Zechariah and greeted Elizabeth. When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the child leaped in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit and exclaimed with a loud cry, "Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb. And why has this happened to me, that the mother of my Lord comes to me? For as soon as I heard the sound of your greeting, the child in my womb leaped for joy. And blessed is she who believed that there would be a fulfillment of what was spoken to her by the Lord." Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Cooper. Good job. Merry Christmas. What a wonderful day today is. One more time. Merry Christmas. We have been waiting for this day to celebrate the birth of Christ during Advent. Therefore, today we ought to worship God with full joy. But some of you may find it difficult to experience joy because of not only the ongoing pandemic, but also your personal problems, like losing your loved ones, financial difficulties, and various health issues. However, no matter how hard your circumstance may be, the fact that you are here to attend today's worship service is proof that you have received the gift of joy from God. Amen? You are the blessed ones. Life is hard. We all understand that more than ever these days. That is why we need to know how God works through our hard times to accomplish His will. In today's scripture, Luke introduced the story of two women. One is Elizabeth, the other is Mary. You are right. You are blessed one. These two women had lived an ordinary life and had not received any attention from society until they experienced the miracle of God. Elizabeth was a priest's wife, but she lived a miserable life because of infertility. In those times, infertility was viewed as a punishment God gave because of a serious sin. When Elizabeth heard from her husband, Zechariah, that the angel had told him the news of the conception of the baby, Elizabeth praised God in Luke chapter 1, 25. In these days, he has shown his favor and taken away my disgrace among the people. But after Elizabeth became pregnant, she remained in seclusion for 5 months in fear that no one would believe her. What about Mary? Mary was a woman who lived in Nazareth, which was known as the poor village of the margins. 6 months passed Since angel Gabriel visited Zechariah, giving the news of the conception of his son, John the Baptist. The same angel, Gabriel, came this time to Mary with the more miraculous news that she would conceive through the power of the Holy Spirit, and that the child she would bear would be the Son of God, the Messiah. According to Luke chapter 1, verse 34, when the angel finished his announcement, Mary was astonished by the news and wondered, "How will this be, since I am a virgin?" However, soon she accepted the miraculous work of God and said, "I am the Lord's slave. May it be done to me according to your word." Although Mary accepted it, still her heart may have filled with fear and awe. At that time, Mary was engaged to Joseph. So if it became known that she was pregnant, not only her engagement with Joseph could be broken, but also it could lead her to be judged by the law, even to death. Thank God that Gabriel gave the additional remarks for Mary in Luke chapter 1, verse 36 and 37. I quote, "Consider your relative Elizabeth. Even she has conceived a son in her old age, and this is the 6th month for her who was called childless. For nothing will be impossible with God." Amen? Nothing will be impossible with God. Do you believe that? Amen. God intended to use the miracle of the conception of John the Baptist to encourage Mary to believe God could do an even bigger miracle, the virginal conception of Jesus. After the angel left, Mary immediately went to visit Elizabeth, who was 6 months pregnant with John the Baptist. When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, she was filled with the Holy Spirit, and the baby leapt in her womb with joy. It was the first encounter between John and Jesus in their mother's wombs. And they grew together in the same era and may have shared their visions of the kingdom of God whenever there was a family gathering, such as the Passover feast, at least once a year. In this way, John and Jesus were spiritual companions during childhood and growing up as a young adult, and helped one another to give their lives to fulfill God's will. When Elizabeth and Mary met, they praised God together. Elizabeth greeted Mary with these famous words, "Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the child you will bear." As Mary listened to Elizabeth's praise, she also became filled with the Holy Spirit and began to praise with a song which begins, My soul glorifies the Lord, and spirit rejoice in God, my Savior. Mary stayed with Elizabeth for 3 months and returned home, ready to accept what had happened by faith and to be prepared for what will happen to her in the future. As such, Mary and Elizabeth became companions on their journey of pregnancies, and after giving birth to their sons, they became prayer partners for each other as they raised their sons, who are certainly not ordinary ones. Now, we call Mary and Elizabeth the most blessed women in history. As I ponder the story of Mary and Elizabeth, I realized an important lesson that we need to learn. Elizabeth and Mary met in fear and awe at first, but their fear turns into joy and praise as they prayed and encouraged together. This should be the way to be practiced in the church community. The principle of church community is togetherness, not aloneness. If there are companions walking together on the journey of faith, no matter how difficult you are or difficult things may happen to you, you can overcome it with praise and prayers in the church community. One person did amen. Amen. Oh, Denise, I love you so much. Okay. God's people say amen. Amen. Ecclesiastes chapter 4, verse 9 and 10 says, two are better than one because they have a good return for their labor. If either of them falls down, one can help the other up. But pity anyone who falls and has no one to help them up. Two are better than one. It's good to have someone to help you get back up, to stand with you as you defend yourself. A cord of three strands is not easily broken. Francis Bacon said, friendship doubles joy and halves grief. Mark Twain said, to get the full value of joy, you must have someone to divide it with. Right? You need someone to share your joy and grief. Do you have a friend who can share life together and count on their friendship no matter what happened to you? Then you have lived a successful life. Thankfully, I have such special spiritual friends. Some of them still get together once a week to pray on Zoom. These are people who joined my Bible study long, long ago. But as we have been praying together for decades now, we have become spiritual friends. Our group consists of a counselor, therapist, professor, and pastor. We have lived faithfully to support each other and to witness how we have fulfilled our respective dreams. And now we know that we are going to journey together as companions till the end. Socrates says, there is no possession more valuable than a good and faithful friend. Throughout the Bible, we see many great friendships. Abraham and Sarah, Moses and Aaron, Caleb and Joshua, David and Jonathan, Peter and John, Paul and Silas, Barnabas and Mark. And we can be certain that their stories without their friends would have been much different. Even Jesus, when he walked this earth, needed friends. He had the 12 apostles whom he chose that they might be with him. Jesus intentionally wanted them with him so that he could train and prepare them. But there was also a matter of fellowship. Jesus liked being with them. He enjoyed eating with them, laughing with them, serving with them, and walking with them to the cross. But the world in which we live is getting more difficult to connect with others because there is more that tends to force us apart rather than draw us together. We are running from work to soccer practice, to the grocery store, to home where we eat dinner in a hurry and then log on to the computer to do the work we didn't finish at the office. And at night, everyone retreats to their castle until a new day begins. We hardly know our neighbors. No wonder we often feel so isolated and alone. Thank you, Steve and Mary's neighbor. Obviously, you knew each other and you wanted to visit your neighbor's church. Wow, that's wonderful. That's wonderful. Dear congregant, the Christmas Sunday, let us acknowledge the message from the scripture that encourages us to keep spiritual friends. Your families and spouses can be your spiritual friends, but I recommend you to find someone outside of your family. It is my prayer that our church can be a community of love and fellowship. I hope that no one in our church community will feel left out. I want them to know that whether they come to church or not, they are still loved. So I hope that our church will have a distinctiveness that sets it apart from other gatherings in society. I'm grateful that Betsy and the church school members will make Christmas baskets for church members today. And our church members are going to deliver Christmas baskets today and this week. I also ask the church council members to keep in touch with the church members. I believe that it is important for church leaders not only to do church work, but also to be able to care for those in need. On this Christmas Sunday, let's think about those who may feel lonely among our church members, and let them know that they are not alone by making phone calls and sending cards. Two are better than one. Two are better than one, because that is God's design. God is three in one, and we should learn from the Trinity. And we need to remember that we as believers are chosen and blessed ones, like Mary and Elizabeth. If we love one another and support each other as companions in Christ, as Mary and Elizabeth did, we can overcome this difficult time together. 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 No matter how the world distracts us, we will stand up as Christians to build communities of love that are not scattered, but together. Then we will overcome the world as the Lord did. The pandemic has been preventing us from being together, but it cannot stop the power of love our church members are burning. Are burning, burning the power of the love. Let's say goodbye to the pandemic together now. Goodbye, pandemic. Please, goodbye. Go away. Never come back. Let's bless each other. Look at your neighbors. What a precious neighbors. And give them this blessing. I give you the blessing of Christmas. Please do it. It's okay to bless your husband. I give you the blessing of Christmas, that baby Jesus came to be with us. I bless you all. I bless you all. I love you with the love of the Lord. Say it to your neighbor. That's okay. It's okay. You can say, I love you, to your wife and husband. It's okay. Merry Christmas! Merry Christmas! Now, let us joyfully sing together. Would you rise? Sing the joy to the world. Yes, yes, that's right.
Thank you.
Go forth and bear Christ's hope to the world. Go forth and bear the mystery of God before others. Go forth and bless the world. We will share the Spirit in all that we say and in all that we do. Amen. Go with God. Merry Christmas.